the glory is for you, Lord. Father, we honor you today. We honor you today. Could you just begin to say from your heart, God, you're worthy. God, you're so worthy. Lord, you're so worthy. You're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our time. You're worthy of our sacrifice. You're worthy, God. You're worthy of relationship. You're worthy of trust. You're worthy, God. You're so worthy of all of our faith. You're so worthy. Father, we honor you today. We thank you, God, for the things that you've done, for the things that you will do. Lord, we just honor you. Lord, we honor your presence. We honor your purpose. We honor your plan. And above all else, we love you today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Why don't you shake hands with somebody you might not have met before? There's some people in the room that you haven't seen maybe for a year. So let's say hello and then we'll be seated.
West to come forth because God wants to heal. up. They're all here. There's still room. So the Lord says, go out to the highways, to the byways. Compel them to come in. We're going to compel them to come in. Amen? Because God wants his house full. Amen? And I just thank God. And I thank God for all of the team here. Once again, amen, it just seems like it was yesterday. The days are flying. This year's already almost over. And it just, where did it all go? But I just want to give a few announcements for Pastor Mark Thomas. You all know Pastor Mark Thomas. His younger son, Mark Jr., passed over the glory on Thursday. And so anyway, that's where Pastor Dennis is at. He's with Pastor Mark. And on Tuesday, they will be having a meeting at Grace Baptist Church, Grace Bible Church, Baptist Church. And so it's going to be on Tuesday at 5 o'clock. So if you can go and just go and love our brother, encourage our brother, amen? That's what we're here for, amen? We weep with them we encourage him. And so it's going to be on Tuesday, Grace Bible Church at 5 o'clock. And the funeral service, we will not know the exact date and time. We will know for sure on Monday whether it's at the reception here and the funeral services at Pastor Overton's church, Lighthouse International. I am so blessed how the body of Christ, it doesn't matter of what denomination, it doesn't matter what label you have in your building. You know, we are the body of Christ. We are about community. And how the body of Christ can work together. We had several pastors here. And we go from every other Wednesday from church to church for prayer and glorifying God. And it's getting bigger and more of the body is coming in. The more the body is coming in. Amen? Amen. And I just thank God for that. And I give him all the glory. Because we are one in him. We are one in him. And so when we are one in him, we are one. We are one. We are one in him. Amen. So anyway, I just wanted to share that. And we're going to continue to share all this. All right. Praise God. Let's give you guys a great big hand. Amen. Give God the glory and just let him have his way. Pastors.
You look beautiful today, Pastor Pee-wee. Ooh, what an amazing fireball for Christ. Yay. Glad to be a part of you. I'm glad she's on my side. Well, another thing that we're going to do, like what Pastor Pee-wee was just talking about, is we're going to go compel them to come in. We're going to go out and take teams this afternoon, so if you'd like to be with us, help us do that. We have flyers that we did this a couple years ago, and it really, really helped increase the awareness of the Amazon giveaway. You've got neighbors, you've got people that you don't even know, that you can knock on their door because you've got something to show them, something to invite them to come to that's a free event. Okay. By the way, my name's Nicole Johnson. I'm from Arkansas. And so we brought a team here this week to help love on you and help you love on your community. So like Pastor Pee-wee said, we're all part of the kingdom of God. And so we're all part of the family of God. If you've said yes to Jesus, then you're my sister and you're my brother. So let's get together this afternoon and let's get the word out because we only have today. Yes, time is short. You hear that Jesus is coming. Well, you know what? He's coming today at 4 o'clock right here in the building. So you want to make sure that you're here and you've got as many people as you can bring right here so that we can bless them and give them Jesus, okay? Right now is my great honor and privilege. privilege to introduce to you my roommate of 30 years. We've been married for 30 years now, Mr. Pastor Phil Johnson. And he had a great time on the drums this morning. I told them when they were rehearsing in the back, I said, "You guys have the cutest drummer, I just got to say." But got some cool pictures there. But he was drumming when I met him. And then my heart just kept beating harder and harder the longer I was with him. Here you go, babe.
Wow, that's, she's always looking for opportunities to try and embarrass me. So if you have your Bibles, would you take just a second with me, because I want to talk for a second just about giving. And would you turn over to Philippians chapter 4. And most everything in Christianity is an issue of trust. We have difficulty trusting people at times, because people have let us down. People have disappointed us, they've betrayed us, they've done things, they've said things behind our backs, and oftentimes we have difficulty trusting people. And if you let it get in you, bitterness will begin to get in you to a point where you have difficulty trusting anyone. You'll become, the enemy will try to pull you into a place of suspicion, of, everybody's out to get me. And that's a miserable existence. How many of you know it's worse than being in prison is being in a self-prison, self-made prison, because you've given into fear, you've given into disappointment. And so what God did was he delivered the Israelites out of Egypt, out of slavery, out of bondage, out of a place where they were literally crying out to God. They were begging God to deliver them. What did he do? He delivered them. He brought them into the wilderness, into a place of complete and utter trust in him. They're in the wilderness. There's no farmland in the wilderness. There's nothing to farm. There's no way for them to be able to provide their own need in the wilderness. And so what did God say? God said, for 6 days, I want you to go out and you're going to collect this little bread that would grow from the ground up, that they wound up calling manna, which means we don't know what it is. That's the name they gave it. We have no idea what it is. But they collected this bread, this seed that they would have to turn into bread. They would actually have to knead it and turn it into bread and bake it. And it tasted, they said, like wafers and honey. Now, I don't know about you, but that sounds pretty good. But have it day in, day out for a while. Suddenly, you start longing for other things, right? But here's what God was trying to do. He said, I want you to go out and collect, and I want you to collect according to your family size. Do you have a Sam's here in Gallup? Sam's Club? No. All right. So Sam's Club, how many of you have been to a Sam's Club? Have you been to a Sam's Club? Okay. So you know what they are. So, you buy basically food in bulk, and so they give you plenty of extra so you can stack your pantry so you have plenty of food, right? That's not what God's allowing them to do. God is saying, I want you to collect just enough for your family. And then once they collect it, he said, on the seventh day, I don't want you to collect any. I don't even want you to go out there. And so they collect all during the week. Some collected more, some collected less. The people that collected more and they tried to stockpile, they tried to put it in their pantry, guess what happened? It had worms all over it and it smelled terrible the next day. So he wouldn't let them do that. But yet on the sixth day, God said, I want you to collect twice as much. Now this is interesting. They collect twice as much, and on that day, the next morning on the seventh day, it doesn't smell and there's no worms. What is God doing with the children of Israel? He is trying to bring them to a place of absolute trust in him. Let me tell you what absolute trust looks like for me. When my daughter turned 16 and I handed her the keys to my car for the first time, to drive by herself. How many of you know I'm in charge because I pay the insurance, I paid for the car. But now I'm no longer in charge. I'm handing her the keys. To me, that was complete trust. But here's what trust does. When you extend trust to someone else, you're extending love to them. What did Jesus say? He said, I don't care if your brother sins against you 7 times in a day and comes back to you and says, I'm so sorry, 7 times. He said, I want you to forgive him each time. So God has them in this place of absolute trust because he's testing them in the wilderness to see if they will obey him. But I want you to notice something. He provided everything they had need of. Plenty of bread. Plenty of water. God caused water to come out of a rock. Flows out of a rock. Plenty of water. Which I would think out here, water's a powerful commodity, isn't it? It's an important thing. So he caused it to come out of a rock. So Phil, where are you going with this? Now let's read Philippians 4. Look at verse 19. I'm going to read it to you out of the New King James Version. It says, and my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. This scripture literally set me free. It set me free from ever believing God to meet my need again. We've been, and if you read earlier in Philippians 4, Paul talks about moments in his life where he had plenty. He had more than enough. But then he had other moments in his life when he was barely scraping by. He didn't know how he was going to make it. He said, but I've learned how to be content in all situations. That's where Philippians 4:13 comes in, where he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What's he talking about? Having faith when you have plenty and having plenty of faith when you have nothing. I want you to look again at verse 19. And my God shall. In your Bible, underline that word, shall. Shall supply. Where in there did it say that I had to do something to receive that? You know what I have to be? I have to be his child, and I have to believe him completely. I have to hand him the car keys of my life and say, God, I fully trust you. Because if you're in here this morning and you're having opportunities with finances, I've got good news for you. And my God shall supply all your need according to his. It's not according to your ability to earn the income. This is important. It's according to his riches and glory. And this is why he said, test me in this. This is the only place that we're allowed to test God in finances. How do you test God? What does he ask for in finances? 10%. It's the word tithe. It's a fancy old English word. This simply means a tenth. 10%. And when I'm faithful to give 10%, then I have every right to expect that Philippians 4:19 is going to happen in my life. That all of my needs shall be met according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And so if you're here and you haven't experienced that, you haven't Father, this morning, Lord, I pray over every person here, Lord, that as they sow, as they give, God, that you would be faithful to your word. Lord, I know you are. You've proven it over and over in my life, and I know it's no different for anyone else. So, Father, I thank you this morning as people give, as people sow seeds of faith into this offering.
Mexico today. I feel like it's coming home. I've got to come for about the last 6 years every year, and I am so blessed to be here. I hope your kids are looking forward to camp this week. I hope that you're going to get to be involved in the distribution of Amazon products this afternoon, but more than that, I want everybody here to experience God this week. I want you to understand God on a level maybe that you haven't understood him on before, because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, but we are not always the same. We're always changing. Some days are good days, some days are bad days. God wants them all to be great days for us, right? He wants to live life with us. He wants to have relationship with us. And this week, we're here to talk about a mission that God has given us that is always possible. So as we're talking about camp this week, we said mission possible, and that seems like a fun theme, and we've got some spy names for the teams, and we got different things we're going to do that are games, and we're trying to look for ways to relate to the kids, relate to the families. But listen, there's a real message about the mission that God's given us being possible, a real message for our lives. It's not just something that's cute and fun for kids. It's a real message that we all have to take to heart and understand the heart of God, because there is a real mission that we're supposed to accomplish while we're here on this planet. There is a real plan that God has. And all through God's word, there's one story after another, after another, after another, about things that did not seem possible with man, but they were possible with God. All right? So we're going to talk about that here just this morning for the next few minutes. And then we're going to pray over those missions, those things in your life, the things in my life that maybe we feel like are kind of impossible, or maybe God's going to drop a new mission in your heart today, and maybe it's going to be bigger than you thought the first time that you thought about it, or the first time that you heard about it, and God's going to do something really supernatural. So can we pray as we get started this morning? Father, I thank you that your word is true, and I thank you, God, that there's enough power in one scripture that can turn a life around, that can turn a generation, that can turn the direction of someone's life that was going the wrong way, and that could turn it to go the other way. And Lord, I just thank you today for that kind of power flowing in this room and ministering to every heart here in Jesus' name. Amen. So I just want to talk about a couple of stories. For those of you, I think everybody probably knows me here. I'm recognizing a lot of familiar faces, but I'm Teresa Gordoa. I'm going to share a little bit more about this as I'm ministering. I have been from Texas for a lot of years, but my husband and I just relocated to Grand Island, Nebraska in the last year. So now I'm here from Nebraska, and lots of changes in my life the last year, which is a mission in and of itself. So I'm going to talk about that here in just a minute. But I'm just delighted to be here and working with John Tash and Tash Ministries, and working, of course, with Joshua Generation for Jesus and anybody who wants to be a blessing to people in Gallup. And so our hearts are excited for what God's going to do this week, and our ministry organization is named Cities for Kids. We've been traveling now for the last 6 years, taking teams from one place to another all across the United States into other countries, and just being a blessing wherever we go to try to help churches and ministries start kids' camps and do something to invest in the lives of kids and families everywhere. So if you're here today and you're with Cities for Kids, would you stand up? These folks are from all over the country. We've got all states,
lots of states represented. Could you give them just a hand clap? We're so glad that we have an opportunity to come and be a part of you guys and be a part of your family this week. So thanks, guys. So one story after another in the scripture that talks about missions that would have been impossible without God. How many of you think that whenever God spoke to Noah to build an ark, when there had never been any rain, when nobody had ever seen anything like that before, when Noah himself had never seen an ark, never built an ark before, this wasn't something that he had done lots and lots of times, and when God spoke to him, he's like, okay, that's familiar, I can just step right into that, that's no problem. That wasn't what that was like. But God desired for Noah to be obedient and follow, even when he didn't understand, so that an entire nation could be salvaged, so that people could have a way out of destruction, right? And so Noah had something that was impossible on his own that became possible when he was obedient to the Lord. After that, the children of Israel were they'd been in bondage and they were being delivered from Egypt. And as they're coming out, there's a multitude of people. They come up to the Red Sea, and then there's Pharaoh's army behind them, and destruction is certain. And there's like no way out. And then God makes a way as the Red Sea began to part and open up, and they began to cross on dry ground. Like, it was miraculous. It was something that couldn't have happened. There was a mission that they were on, and it looked like the mission was not going to be possible. It looked like they weren't going to be able to accomplish what God said to do, and they looked like there was no hope. But when you turn to God in a situation like that and you say, God, I can't do it on my own, this is only going to happen through your power and through your ability, that's when you begin to see the hand of God move. Amen. What about the disciples, like all of the disciples that followed Jesus? There were 11 of them after Jesus had been crucified. And then they added another one after that so that there were 12. And they went around and they preached the gospel. And it wasn't easy. It was difficult. There was persecution everywhere that they went. All of them except John were martyred for their faith. And in that moment when they were being martyred and it looked like the mission was not accomplished, they actually were able to accomplish more in their death than they were able to accomplish in life. The mission is always possible whenever we're following God. Whenever we learn to speak the name of Jesus and expect God to move and we're trusting his ability and not our own, the mission becomes possible. Those are just a few of the stories. I could go on and on about all the different things. If you probably some of those stories are going through your own mind right now, of things that we've read in the scripture, times where it didn't look like it would be able to work out, but people turned to the power of God and God moved on their behalf every time. Listen, if God calls you to do something, then he will help you to accomplish that. If you stay the course, if you don't give up, if you don't go off track, if you don't turn around and run like Jonah, right? God had a mission for Jonah. Jonah said, I don't want to do that mission. In fact, I don't like them. I don't want to go minister to those people. As far as I'm concerned, they can go to hell. I don't want to have anything to do with them. And he ran from the call of God. Right? You know the story? And he ended up in the belly of a fish for 3 days. Right? And only whenever he decided to be submissive to God did he end up being able to come out of that difficulty, out of what was certain death, and say, I'm going to do what God called me to do in the first place. And he began to preach to the people that he didn't have a heart for, that he wasn't concerned about their well-being. And he preached them what God told him to do, and it changed an entire community. Right? Like, there's just one story after another. So as long as we'll stay the course, like, God can always come through for us. And I just want to share this bit of testimony. God put this in my heart just to share this morning. My husband and I have been married for almost 34 years. And we got married when we were young. I was 18. He was 19. And we had only been married for about a month, and I got pregnant. And I was so excited. All I had ever wanted was to be married and have children. And I love ministry, and I love getting to do what I do this at this point in my life, but this is not what I set out to do. I just wanted to be married and have children. Like, that was like the deepest desire of my heart. So when we got pregnant right away, I was so excited. It was like just a dream come true. And about 10 months later, because I went way overdue, birth to our first son, and he only lived for 2 days. And he died in my arms. And we had to stand at a graveside for our child. I'm telling you, there's like, it just shouldn't be that way. No parent should have to bury their child. It was hard. The whole dream in my heart that I had had since I was a little girl, I had a moment of decision. Am I going to give up on the dream because the fight and the cost is too great? Or am I going to continue to believe that what God promised me is true and keep walking in faith and trusting God with my life? So I had been raised in a church to believe that anything that happened was the plan of God, good or bad, because he's sovereign. And that's really not an accurate way to say scripture. Yeah, God's in control of like so many things, but he set some things in motion, right, in the earth. And there's so much of man's decision that alters the way God intended for it to go. And so I had learned this right before that attack in our life, that anything good is from God and everything bad is from the devil. So I knew the devil had stole from my life. But I was like, that's not fair either. I love Jesus. Hey, listen, why do we think that because we love Jesus that bad things won't happen? Why do we think that just because we love Jesus that it's always going to just go the way that God wants it to go and the way that we want it to go? Listen, that's not what the Bible teaches, but we try to grab onto that because we know God's good, and we try to convince ourselves that we can just, you know, go from one thing to the next, and the challenges in the world not affect us the way that it does others. The Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust, right? There's going to be challenges in life. I'll come back to that in a minute. So in that moment, I said to my husband, I know that this is not from God. I know that the devil stole from us, but I feel so let down. I feel so disappointed. And my husband said this. He said, I know. He said, but I feel like we have three choices. He said, I feel like we can say, forget God. Why would we serve him? This is too disappointing, and we can walk away and not have a relationship with him, and then we could end up having no eternity with God and be in hell. I said, that's a bad option. Or he said, we can say, okay, forget the faith message, forget trusting God, forget believing in miracles, forget that, and let's just say it doesn't work. He said, and we can live defeated lives until Jesus comes back. He said, or we can say, you know what, that doesn't line up with what I believe the Bible says, and I don't know exactly what happened, but I can still believe that God's word is true, and we can still press in and do all that we feel like God has called us to do, right? And I said, you know what, option number three, let's do that. The mission is possible, guys. The mission is possible. No matter what defeat you've had, no matter what disappointment you've had, we began to trust God then. We said, okay, well, we're still gonna have a family. We believe God promised us to have a family. And in that moment, like within, probably 4 months or so after that happened, we were ready to try for another child. And then we began about a 15-year battle with infertility. I got pregnant the first month we were married. Like, infertility was not an issue. And then all of a sudden it was. And so it took a full 16 years for us to have all four of the children that we believe that God promised us. It took a while. It took some fighting, but we did. And we had all four kids. And then along the way, I adopted another one, and then I adopted a few others. And so we have like a multitude of kids and spiritual kids now that are just almost too many to count. And so God is faithful if we'll just keep trusting him no matter what the situation seems like. So I said all of that to say this. This last year brought one of the toughest challenges of my life. Probably the toughest. And I said that last year. And I was like, okay, so this is tough. So last year about this time, there's a church in Grand Island, Nebraska that did not have a pastor. And we had done a couple of camps there, and I was in relationship with them, and they said, we need help. And we said, we'll help. How can we help? Like, we'll preach for you. We'll put the word out. We'll tell people about what you got going on here and that there's an opportunity, and say, pray about it. And like, we talked to all of our friends. We were like, have you considered maybe moving to Nebraska and helping a church there that needs a pastor? I mean, we just were everything. And then they started saying, well, what about go to Nebraska because that's just not. And let me tell you why. It was not my plan. My parents died in a car wreck when I was 2. And my grandparents raised me. And it was wonderful. I had a great childhood. I never really had grandparents, though, because my grandparents had to become my parents. And then when Frank and I got married and we started a family, my parents had died and his mother had died. So my children only had one living grandparent that lived in Dallas, not close enough really to be that involved in my kids' lives. And so I felt like my kids just kind of grew up without those grandparents. And so, I mean, God brought people and they had a lot of people in their life and God was faithful. But I just made a decision that I'm going to live long and I'm going to live strong because I'm going to be here for my kids and I'm going to be here for my grandkids. So when God said, consider moving to another state and leaving your grandkids in Texas, I couldn't wrap my head around it. I said, that cannot be the Lord. There's just no way that that is what I am supposed to do. And I struggled. In fact, you know what? That's not true. I didn't struggle at first. I didn't even consider it at first. I said no. And about a few months later, Frank was going to go preach for them. And because he had said, I'll preach, I'll do whatever you need to do. So I was going to cover the church in Texas. He was going to go preach in Nebraska. And they were talking about having a board meeting. I said, a board meeting? Why are they having a board meeting? That sounds like an interview. You told them no, right? Like, you made it really clear that we are not doing that. And he's like, babe, I told him, like, God can speak to me, but that's not what we think we're supposed to do. And he's like, so, and I'm like, oh, man. Don't disappoint them. Don't let them think that we are going to move there. He's like, okay. He goes, he preaches. Sure enough, there's an interview. It's just like an interview. And I'm like, this is going to be so sad. They're going to be so disappointed. And so then, a couple months later, I'm not thinking about it. I have no consideration to go, none whatsoever. And a couple months later, we're about ready to go do a camp in Nebraska, close to where that church is located. I said, I'm praying for the team. I always do the week before camp. I'm praying for the team. I knew that there would be some people from Grand Island there. I said, God bless them. God give them a pastor. God bring someone wonderful to their church, Lord. I want them to be blessed. I want them to have something fantastic, Lord. And as I'm saying that, the Lord said to me, he said, you know, you haven't even asked me what I think. To a place where I could say yes to the Lord. I said yes on the outside, but my heart wasn't fully in it yet, right? Can I tell you, it has not been easy. We had been pastoring in Dumas for 19 years. The people there are like family. It wasn't just my grandkids. It was all the connections that we had had, the community, the people. My oldest son said to me, he said, Mom, you can't do that. I said, why, babe? You don't live here. I said, you're traveling the world. You're in the Navy. Like, why do you think that? He said, Mom, because they need you there. He said, if you leave, it'll leave a hole that cannot be filled. I said, oh God, how can this be you? We were connected. It was hard. It was so hard. But there were also a group in Grand Island, Nebraska that were like, my heart was compelled to go because that was the plan of God. It was what he was asking us to do. So it was really hard to love all of these people and want the best for all of them and try to hear, God, what is your plan, though? What is your desire? I talked to Cross, our youngest son. He was going to be starting his senior year, his last year of high school. I said, God, I can't leave my grandkids. I can't relocate my son in his senior year of high school. And so we're going to say something to him about it. Hey, son, guess what? This church in Nebraska wants us to come. We know that's not even an option. We would never relocate you in your senior year. He said, I would go today. Yeah. I said, well, that's 50% of my argument gone. Like right there. He said to me, Mom, I believe we're supposed to move here. I said, yeah, but how do you know? I said, are you praying? Are you asking God? He's like, it would just be better if we came. I said, you don't know that. You don't know if it would be better. And if it wasn't better and it was really bad, if we knew it was God, we'd be okay. But if we don't know it's God, then we'd be frustrated and we'd be doubting ourselves. So we got to know. And I said, I don't want you. direct your life, so you got to learn to really pray some things through. And he said, Mom, whether I move to Nebraska this year or next year, I'm for sure coming. I said, really, you believe that this is where your future's at? He said, I do. I said, okay, well, now this is a whole nother realm. This isn't just me saying I'm not willing to go. This is me. Am I gonna hold him back? Am I gonna stand in the way of what God wants him to do? Am I gonna stand in the way of the mission that God has for him? And you know, my 17-year-old son moved to another state without us to do what he felt like God called him to do. I was tough on the mom that said, I'm gonna always be there for my kid. I'm always gonna be there for my grandkids. That was tough. But he had a dream in his heart, he had a mission in his heart, and I knew that I couldn't stand in the way of that. So as he went, it was one of the most difficult decisions I've ever made as a parent, to let him follow his dream, even though I couldn't be there to watch it. Because we couldn't move to Grand Island right away. We had to make sure that the church that we were at had the right pastors in place. So it was a transition time. So Cross lived with a family in Nebraska. He moved up there. In the school that he went to, he didn't know, I mean, he might have known a couple of people, but he didn't know anybody really well at 17. Listen, God has a mission for every single one of us. He has something that he's placed in your heart, something that he's called you to do, something that he wants you to accomplish. And it's important that we listen to those things and that we begin to take steps to fulfill the mission. What big thing does God have in your heart today? What big thing is in your heart? What mission has God called you to? This seems impossible. Now, there's a couple of things that you can do to recognize that. Number one, it's always going to be bigger than you think. It's not going to be something that you can accomplish on your own. It's going to take the power of God. So if the dream that's in your heart is something that you feel like you can do, that's a great vision for your life, but that's not the mission. Do you understand? So I was thinking about Cross. So my son Cross is an athlete, and he plays soccer, and he has played soccer since he was very young. And when he became a freshman in high school, he put one goal in front of him about being able to play college soccer. What do I need to do to play college soccer? And I've watched him since he was 14 and a half years old. I've watched him work out. I've watched him be consistent. I've watched him be faithful. I've watched him change the way he eats. I've watched him do all of these things. He sits and watches soccer on YouTube. Like, he watches stuff over and over. He does, what does it take to, like, be good? How can I improve? How can I be better? What do I need to do? And I've watched him do that without a coach that would push him along, without a whole lot of outward encouragement. It was a dream in his heart. And can I tell you, I love to watch him play soccer. I love it. I love it so much. I love watching him play soccer almost as much as I love going to church. And there are probably a few times I would rather watch him play soccer than go to church. I love watching him. I love it. He's gifted. I love watching him do it. He's passionate about it. But Cross, in all of your ability and all of your gifting, if that's all you, then that's as far as it'll ever take you. If the dream in your heart isn't beyond your own ability, if it isn't beyond your gifting, then it'll only take you to places that are great, but they won't be impactful for a nation. So follow your dream. Do those things in your heart. Have a vision for your life, but make sure that there's a mission that you're accomplishing as well. What is there along the way that God expects you to change and shift and affect those that are around you? The mission is never just about you. It's never just about your family. It's never just about what you can see right close to you. It's always supposed to impact somebody else. So that's one way to understand whether you've got a mission or whether you're just walking in a vision for your life. The other thing, just a couple things real quickly, it's probably not going to happen the way that you think. It probably is not going to look like you thought it would look. I mean, who thought that a group of worshipers would be the first into battle? But that's how the victory came. wasn't what they thought. It was a mission from God. It didn't happen the way they thought it would, but if they listened to the voice of the Holy Spirit, then victory always came. What about whenever the walls of Jericho needed to come down? Like, who would have thought that a group of people walking around a big wall and not talking would actually cause a wall to fall? Right? Well, of course, it was the shout that actually caused the wall to fall. Everybody had to be quiet for days. And then there was a big shout that caused the wall to fall. Now listen, it was the instruction of the Lord, the mission of God, that caused it to be successful. We have to listen to what God wants us to do to see those results and to fulfill the mission. Even Jesus, when he came to give his life to be the redeemer for all mankind, it did not look like what the children of Israel thought it would look like, and so they crucified him. It didn't look like what they thought, and so they rejected him. And the people that he came to save, the people that he came to give his life for, he's on the cross, and they're mocking him, and they're crucifying him. They're destroying, it looked like, his life. And in that moment, he said, "Father, forgive them, because they don't know. They don't know what they're doing." And he offered forgiveness in a moment of betrayal unlike any in human history. And it didn't look like our victory was purchased, but that's exactly what happened. It was the mission that God had for him, the mission that God had for his one and only son to fulfill. So the mission is probably never going to look exactly like what you think. So don't just get your heart set on one way. God doesn't change his mind. If there was a mission in your heart 5 years ago that's not alive today, God hasn't changed his mind. It's still the desire and the mission for your life. If God gifted you to do something 10 years ago and you're not walking in that today, God still hasn't changed his mind. The Bible says he's not a man that he should repent, or the son of man that he should lie. He hasn't changed his mind. So let those dreams and visions and let that mission begin to live again. And the last thing that I want to say is, another way to recognize whether you're on a mission from God or not is there will always be a fight. If you're not having to fight for the mission, then it's not a mission. Why do we think that just because we love God and we have a mission from God that it's just all going to come easy? And then when it doesn't, we get discouraged and we quit. Why do we think that? Every mission that has ever been ordained by God has always taken a fight to accomplish. So don't give up. Don't back down. Let those dreams on the inside of your heart that God put there, let him bring those to pass. Let him have that vision live again in your heart. Would you just bow your head right now? Close your eyes. God, I'm just asking you by your Spirit just to begin to minister to every heart in this room. Did you have a dream for a ministry that you feel like hasn't come to pass? Did you have a dream for your family that doesn't look like what you thought it would? Maybe there's been brokenness. Maybe there's been divorce. Maybe there's been broken relationships. Maybe there's been challenges that have been devastating to your home. Decisions that were made that were out of your control, but it had an effect on the mission. Don't let that mission die. Don't give up. Lord, right now I just speak to broken dreams. I speak to the mission, God, that you've placed on the inside of each one of our lives. The giftings that go along with it, but not just the gift, Father, not just stirring up a gift, but God, I pray that the mission would become clear again, that the direction that you've called us to, Father, would be clear in our heart, clear in the way we think, clear in the way we see. I bind all confusion and doubt and strife that has tried to steal the mission. In Jesus' name. Have you stepped off the path that God had for you? gotten involved in civilian life instead of living the life of a good soldier and being focused on what God has before you? Have distractions come? Have they pulled you off course? Today you can get right back on task. You can be right back on the mission that God has for you. Father, every heart, in the name of Jesus. Have you grown discouraged? Have you lost the desire to fight? Has the battle been too long? Are you just tired? Do you feel beaten down? God wants to heal that right now. He wants to give you fresh purpose. He wants to restore life to that dream and that mission.
Also with him who believes. And so I pray, Lord, for Pee-wee, the way that you prayed for Peter, that her faith would remain firm. I just feel like the Lord would say that your past is not your future, Pee-wee. What's happened is behind you. And God today is turning your head from where you've been and turning it toward where he is taking you, to the destination that he has in mind. And it's a good land. He said, I know the plans I have for you. They're not plans to harm you, but they're plans to give you a future and a hope. And I'm here to declare that your best days are out in front of you. They're not behind you. They're still in front of you. And so, Father, Father, I pray for freedom over Pee-wee. Pastor Pee-wee, Lord, I pray for your freedom, for your liberty in her life again, for her freshness. Lord, for the restoration of first love. For the restoration of a passion. Again, Lord, that this house would come back again to what you started it as, and that's Jesus, a focus on lifting up the person Jesus. Lord, I thank you for this vision of the bride and the bridegroom that stand over this platform, and I thank you, Father, that that's who you've called us to be, a bride that longs